Hello and welcome to Livewire Markets. My name is Chris Conway. Today I'm joined by Roy Keenan, co-head of fixed income at Yarra Capital Management and also head of the Yarra Enhanced Income Fund. Roy has more than 30 years of experience in financial markets and he joins us as part of Livewire's 2023 Income Series. Roy, thanks for joining us for Livewire's Income Series for 2023. I wanted to start by getting your view on the current interest rate cycle, very contentious at the moment. Have central banks gone too far? And how is that impacting the type of investments that you're looking for?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question because we look at the way we think about the markets and this current cycle. We'd sort of been talking about inflation. Maybe it's the senior guys in my team, but we've been talking inflation for years. And when the world was sort of thinking it was transitory, we were quite the opposite. Obviously, Ukraine changed that, but ultimately, we're not surprised by the actual direction of interest rates. Mm-hmm. What we are surprised about is how far the central bank has gone. And in our view, the last couple tightenings that we've seen is probably going too far.
Roy, let's talk economy. So the RBA has revealed modelling with recession risk as high as 80%. Do you factor that into the way you look at your portfolio and the way you invest?
Absolutely. As I just mentioned, if the central bank has gone too far in tightening, then you've got to assess the impact on the economy. And I think for us, that's about, because we're credit investors, is how do companies perform in that environment? How does a consumer perform? And for us, what's quite unique about this sort of part of the cycle is that Australian companies and corporate Australia have actually entered this cycle in really good shape. So it's really confusing because balance sheets are in great shape, but we can see looking 12 months out, if there is a recession caused by a policy mistake, mm-hmm. then we need to start thinking about where we're investing. Mm-hmm. And in some ways we're sort of defensively invested as a credit investor today. And we're sort of getting really ready to pull the trigger on adding some risk, but it's probably not at the right time now because of what we're seeing from the central bank. We're trying to avoid consumer discretionary, trying to avoid consumer finance, happy with some sectors of property market, but they're the sort of things that we bring into our mind is not only when's the time to add risk, but where do we want to invest?
Roy, I just want to ask a follow-up question there. It's not one that's on the sheet, but yeah. For someone with your experience, more than 30 years in markets, how hard is it to keep the powder dry and, if you are seeing opportunities, not pursue them at potentially the wrong time?
Yeah, it's really important. Three months ago when the RBA paused, we were sort of starting to think that was the time to, add, but we wanted to wait and see.
Right.
Because if they didn't tighten, and these last two, if we think they are a policy mistake, then, for us, it's, we have to actually probably going to get better opportunities to invest in. And that's the key point, right, is trying to pick the right timing, trying to find those relative value trades out there. But it sort of clouds the picture.
Yeah.
And that's the most important time. So for us, it's about picking the right time.
Your recent monthly, Roy, talked to, I want to get this quote right, high levels of income likely to be a theme throughout 2023. How long can that be sustained given the macroeconomic headwinds that are out there?
That's changed in the last 4 weeks, right? If you'd asked me that a couple of months ago, I would have said, that we're going to really have to work hard to protect that income.
Mm-hmm.
What with, cash rates going to 4.1, we've just had 3-year bonds hit a, 12-year, high.
Yep.
It's hard to see this not being sustained for the next 18 months, 24 yeah. months. And I think that makes my job a lot easier. The more income I get,
yep.
especially my portfolio's floating rate. 70% of portfolio's floating rate. It's happy days for an income investor.
Portfolio, Roy, it holds between 60 and 100 securities. I know it's not an equities portfolio, but by comparison, that's a lot. What are the characteristics that you're looking for across all those positions and why so many, I guess?
Yeah, it can be a bit misleading, securities, because in fixed income, if I use Commonwealth Bank, for example,
yep.
There's one equity, right? But in fixed income markets, Commonwealth Bank is used across senior,
right.
subordinated debt, tier two, tier one. So we might have 5 Commonwealth Bank securities in our portfolio. So the way we try to look at the portfolios, we've got 106 securities today,
mm-hmm.
From 50 issuers. But what we're looking to try and achieve is a diversified portfolio. We're obviously happy to invest in higher quality companies, allocate more of our fund to that. Mm-hmm. And obviously companies which are lower quality will invest a little bits amount. And in those parts of the market, you want to have diversification just in case something goes wrong.
Roy, you touched on it there, the capital structure in terms of the CBA securities. Can you give investors a 101 on capital structure and then explain where you like to invest within the capital structure and perhaps why as well?
I was about to say it's pretty simple. The more risk you take, the more return you want. And right. Ultimately, that's what it is. If you look at the bank capital structure, you obviously start at term deposits. You can have covered bonds, RMBS from a bank, senior securities, tier two, tier one. My job as a portfolio manager is trying to identify, it's the same bank, right? Commonwealth Bank, if I use that as an example. So, trying to find that relative value, and ultimately my aim is to get paid for risk I'm taking. Yep. And if I'm not getting paid for risk, I shouldn't be there. So what happens across the capital structure is that, sometimes things get out of whack. And that's where we're trying to do that relative value trade.
Fantastic. Roy, in an interview in January this year, you were talking about adding duration. Now, you've already talked about how things have changed, but the preference then was investment grade over high yield. Is that still the case?
Absolutely. Yeah. As I mentioned, 3-year bonds are 12-year high today. I just think adding duration, and we're not going crazy. We're adding, we currently have the fund at about 1.5 years duration, interest rate duration. In some ways, that's a bit of protection for my credit fund as well, because if you think about it, if the economy doesn't do so well, goes into recession, God forbid, what you will see happen is interest rates start to turn and rally, central bank starts to ease. So what you will have is maybe a deteriorating credit cycle, but what you lose from the credit side of the equation, you'll gain from having some interest rate exposure. So, and that I think that's probably in today's environment a good place to be. IG versus high yield, if you look through history, especially in the US, which has a lot more historical credit data than what we have, it tells you that investing into IG companies at this point of the cycle is the place to be. They don't experience defaults, and therefore it's safer. In high yield, we all know that in this sort of rising interest rate costs, borrowing costs, companies are geared more. Who probably don't have pricing power in their products can't really move as quickly in this sort of framework, in this environment. So we just don't think it's the right time to be sort of allocating to high yield at the moment.
Roy, as funding costs tighten, there's expected to be a lot of new issuance. Do you think the market will be able to absorb that? How is it likely to be received?
Yeah, look, I think it's a really interesting point because we've gone through this term funding facility where cheap funding was available to banks who then pass it on corporate Australia and to to mortgage customers and vice versa. That's reversing, right? So yeah. So what we expect is more issuance to come. I think the market ability to absorb it will be there. Deals have to be priced correctly, which is really, really important. If I think about myself, I'm defensively positioned. So if a good deal comes along, which might have a little bit more risk, is priced correctly, I'm going to be happy to add because I've got probably higher elevated levels of cash, but I'm also looking to add risk at this point.
Roy, last question. Yarra covers almost all segments of the fixed income market. That's a rarity in Australia. What are you seeing as you look across that entire landscape, and why is it important that investors have that holistic view?
Yeah, it's a good question, especially at this point of where we see the economy. We invest in from government bonds right through to private credit, so right across fixed income. And one thing we're noticing is obviously the consumer's a bit distressed at the moment, obviously, especially with higher mortgage costs. But we're also seeing in probably the high yield private credit type where you've got lower credit rating, more gearing, that companies are starting to struggle with the amount of debt they have with higher interest costs at a time when consumers are starting to struggle at the same time. So you're starting to get a hit from revenue and a compression in margins and high costs coming through the business, which is creating problems out in particular parts of the marketplace. That being said, we think there's some really good opportunities out in the market, especially in the RMBS space. We've been not in my fund, but across our business, we've been allocating and probably running the highest risk we've had in RMBS for a while. And we've also been allocating to what we like in fixed rate tier two securities, which we think that's a really good point, segment of the marketplace.
Roy Keenan, thanks for joining us for Live Wire Markets Income Series for 2023.
It's great to be here.
If you liked that interview as much as I did, make sure to give it a like and don't forget to follow our YouTube channel because we're adding great new content every single week.